Another good question is, where did my video go? So if I go to my videos. Captures, oh no, set it back here. Yep. So whatever software you're using to capture the clip, you want to make sure that you know where your folder is that you're exporting to. Or at least what the file name is going to be. usually the way that I did it, it'll show up in your recent file since it's done natively. So in this, we can now crop and use in After Effects. Of course, the preview is a little slow, or the frames kind of skip a little bit. So that's, I'm afraid, just an issue with doing it that way. The proper way to do it would be to export your frames, but this allows you to start setting up different effects on something if you just have it sketched out. And later, after you've done all your effects in After Effects, you can simply switch out the clips. And as long as you get your timing right, you can basically overlay a newly rendered animation and replace it with this quick little recording that you do. Okay, so, a way to make it smoother actually when you do that recording is to increase the amount of frames. So if I set up the animation again, I'm just gonna go over the whole process once more. So if you missed out on anything, that would be the time to pay attention, and then I'll take questions. So if I increase the number of frames to 600, right? That would be a crazy amount of frames to export, but I'm not concerned about that. I'm more concerned with how many steps there are in the animation, because if I put 600 frames, now it means that the line has 600 points to go through. So if I do okay, and we do that once more, well, I have to set up my recording. All right, so I'm recording, play the animation, switch to rendered. Right, so now it's going a lot slower, but I'm getting a lot more frames, even just like recording right now on my screen. Set animation is one of them, but yes, yeah, set path animation, correct, is the one that I'm using right now to set up a camera path and a target path. By the way, as we're waiting, this is the D5 project, D6. This is D6 I had with Professor Chandler, the Corbusier house. I forget the specific name of the house, if anybody wants to help me out with that. All right, that's good enough. So I'll stop my recording there. Okay, so just an additional way besides the videos already included, Ville Savoy. Just another way to set up a animation out of Rhino that's very, very simple. And with this, we're gonna move on to After Effects. Before I do, are there any questions? Would the capture have voice? I'm assuming it would, yes, record the voice as it's recording the meeting. Yes, I have tried the recording. It does have audio. Okay, no more questions. All right, can I get a couple okay? Make sure we're good. We have 200 participants. All right. So, now it's time to move from Rhino into, actually before I do, let me do something. Since I had that clipping plane, you can start opening up your After Effects if you want to follow along. Now we're going to move over to that. But if I'm enabling my clipping plane now and I export that same recording, I can get the animation to overlay with a section of it. So I really want to see how that turns out. I go ahead and record now. The same thing, but with a clipping plane enabled through the model. And so this should match my previous export. For those of you familiar with Photoshops, you want to think of After Effects as basically a Photoshop that uses Illustrator elements to put things into motion, is basically how to best describe it. So just like in Photoshop, you would maybe layer a section on top of a 3D view of a model in order to maybe blend them together or so on. You would do the same, it's the same approach for After Effects. So that's why Photoshop is a very powerful tool for using in After Effects as well. Because you can set up your scenes, you can set up your assets in Photoshop, and they'll always update into After Effects.